Eucharistic Congress. The event in Hungary continues with a focus on the Eastern Rite of the Catholic Church. We have a report from Budapest. Fight for the unborn. What the head of the Archdiocese of Washington is saying about President Joe Biden's recent remarks on his support for abortion rights. Crisis in Afghanistan. New developments in the push to airlift Americans out of the country. And honoring a saint. Why people in Northern Ireland are remembering a beloved Catholic figure who died in a concentration camp 80 years ago. On EWTN News Nightly for Thursday, September 9th, 2021. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. I'm Tracy Sable. The 52nd International Eucharistic Congress continues in Budapest. There is growing anticipation for the arrival of Pope Francis on Sunday, and there is a lot of work to be done before the Holy Father's closing Mass. Yesterday afternoon, a divine liturgy from the Eastern Rite of the Catholic Church was celebrated at St. Stephen's Basilica in Budapest. Today, the main events were workshops and Eucharistic adoration. Tomorrow's schedule is dedicated to young people. Joining us now from Budapest is Matthew Bunson, EWTN Executive Editor and Washington Bureau Chief. Matthew, welcome back. Great to see you. As we just heard yesterday, an Eastern Rite Divine Liturgy was celebrated in the main cathedral in Budapest. What more can you tell us about that? And why was the Divine Liturgy included in this event?
Well, it's great to be with you, Tracy. The Divine Liturgy in this case was a Byzantine liturgy. It was celebrated by Yusuf Absi, who is the patriarch of the Melkite Catholics. And it was, in a word, a magnificent liturgy, as the Byzantine liturgies are. The point of the event, a couple of things were at work here. The first is that this is an International Eucharistic Congress. It is an opportunity for us to reflect on the Blessed Sacrament. And having the Divine Liturgy, which is the Mass, is one of the key focal points. Including the Eastern Rite Catholics is very important if we are a universal church. There are 20-plus Eastern Catholic churches who belong to the universal church. So this was an expression of that universality, and what an expression it was.
Yeah, and as we know, this is the fifth day of the Eucharistic Congress. Can you talk about maybe some of the highlights so far?
Well, there have been a number of notable talks here. Every day is built around catechesis, around testimonies, as well as some workshops. One of the highlights, we're talking about the Eastern churches, one of the big highlights came very early on in this Eucharistic Congress, and that was the presentation of catechesis by Metropolitan Hilarion Alfeyev, who's a representative of the Eastern Orthodox, the Russian Orthodox Patriarchate of Moscow. His presence here was significant, both as a symbol, but also as a testament from the Orthodox about the real presence, that they too want to reaffirm that, especially in an era of secularization, relativism, and a loss of faith. Another very interesting presentation was just today, and that was Cardinal John Oneakan, the Archbishop Emeritus of Abuja in Nigeria, who gave a classic catechesis on the Eucharist, making some very important points, including the worthiness to receive, and he was willing to weigh in even on the question of politicians receiving communion.
And can you tell us how Budapest is preparing to welcome Pope Francis?
Well, since Sunday, when we had the opening Mass and the opening ceremony, everyone has been anticipating the arrival of Pope Francis here on Sunday as part of his trip to Hungary and then also to Slovakia. Any papal trip brings with it both the church dimensions and then also political and cultural and social dimensions. For Pope Francis, this is his opportunity to come to a Eucharistic Congress to add his catechesis and his testimony in the belief in the real presence. But then there's also the political side. He'll be meeting with various political leaders here, as well as cultural leaders, and doing the same thing in Bratislava in Slovakia. So it's a papal trip that the people here are very much anticipating, and I think the expectation is for very large crowds in what is going to be very good weather, we might add.
And Matthew, before I let you go, any final thoughts or anything else that you'd like to share with our viewers?
Yes, I think the value of an International Eucharistic Congress like this, this is the 52nd in the history of all of the congresses, is for all of us to take a little time and reflect on the Eucharist, on the real presence in our lives, and then also go to EWTN.com, and you can actually download and watch so many of the sessions here. There's a lot to be gained from that, and reminding ourselves every day of the importance of the Eucharist in our lives and being worthy of it, certainly by availing ourselves of the sacrament of penance and then presenting ourselves at every opportunity for Mass and adoration.
Well, Matthew, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us. We appreciate it. Matthew Bunson, EWTN Executive Editor and Washington Bureau Chief. Great to be with you.
God bless.
Well, this morning at the Vatican, the Holy Father met the President of Chile. Pope Francis and Sebastian Piñera reiterated their commitment to helping the poor and the vulnerable. They also discussed the role the Church plays in the country's political sphere. Chile is around two-thirds Catholic. Well, here in the United States, the Archbishop of Washington, D.C. is clarifying what the Church teaches on when life begins, saying that he was prompted to do so after remarks last week in which President Joe Biden again expressed support for abortion rights.
The Catholic Church teaches and has taught that life, human life, begins at conception. So the president is not demonstrating Catholic teaching.
Last week, President Biden stated that he did not agree with the Catholic position that life begins at conception. This afternoon, the Justice Department announced that it filed a lawsuit against Texas challenging the state's heartbeat law. Well, the White House says that it is, quote, working overtime every night, all night, on helping people who want to leave Afghanistan get out of that country, which was overrun by the Taliban. And today, Americans were among several passengers on a plane that left Kabul on an international commercial flight. But there is still great uncertainty as to what the coming days and weeks will bring. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports. Owen?
Tracy, today the White House National Security Council released a statement on that Qatar Airways charter flight out of Afghanistan, thanking both Qatar and the Taliban for their assistance, even calling the brutal and repressive Taliban regime businesslike and professional.
In the White House press briefing room, an update on the effort to bring Americans out of Afghanistan. As for how many Americans on the flight today?
Well, as we noted in the statement, the plane just landed, and what we want to do is check all of the manifests on the ground and ensure we have the accurate number for all of you. We'll have that number out from the State Department.
Around 200 people, including Americans, flew out of Afghanistan on a Qatar Airways flight to Doha.
In order to get those people out, we had to work with some members of the Taliban to press them and to work in a business-like manner to get them out.
However, it's not clear what the resumption of international flights over the next few days will mean for the tens of thousands of Afghans desperate to flee, with the Taliban now in control. Meanwhile, former Afghan President Hamid Karzai is calling on the Taliban to form a more inclusive government, including women. Members of the Taliban, and were not showing the video due to its graphic nature, were seen using whips against women at one protest. Also, the NATO Secretary General has said the Taliban must make good on their commitment to safe passage for those who wish to leave Afghanistan. As for the pressure that can be applied,
of course, our leverage is not the same as it was when we had military troops on the ground, but we still have leverage, economic, diplomatic, political leverage on Taliban.
And back at the Kabul airport, a Qatari envoy says another 200 passengers will leave Afghanistan on Friday. Again, it was not immediately clear how many Americans were on board today and how many were still in Afghanistan. Before the flight, the U.S. believed roughly 100 American citizens remained in the country. Other estimates say the number is much higher.
Among those on the flight today, a 12-year-old boy and his family. He says they live in Maryland. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
On Capitol Hill, House committees are finalizing details of the Democrat-backed $3.5 trillion budget resolution. The proposal includes most of President Biden's economic agenda. Democrats say the plan will be good for the country.
We have a once-in-a-generational opportunity to make transformative, beneficial change. This is our moment to lay a new foundation of opportunity for the American people.
Our Representative Richard Neal from Massachusetts joins Democrats who are in favor of the measure. Republicans remain very skeptical.
Today, Speaker Pelosi and House Democrats begin ramming through trillions of wasteful spending and crippling tax hikes that will drive prices up even higher, kill millions of American jobs, and usher in a new era of government dependency with the greatest expansion of the welfare state in our lifetimes.
House leadership says that it is hoping to have committees finish writing the reconciliation package by early next week. France says that it will offer free birth control to all women up to the age of 25. The country currently offers it up until the age of 18. Abortions in France also are free of charge. The expansion of birth control begins January 1st. At least 14 people in North Macedonia have died following an explosion at a field hospital for coronavirus patients. The blast injured dozens of others. The cause is unknown, but there is speculation that it may be linked to oxygen supplies. Local hospitals are at maximum capacity due to a recent spike in infections. In honor of those killed in the fire, the city's mayor has declared 3 days of mourning. Japan is extending its coronavirus state of emergency for most of the country until the end of the month. Prime Minister Yoshida Suga says the country still faces a high rate of serious cases, and there are fears that hospitals are reaching their capacity. He calls for remote working and other social distancing measures. Coming up, Beijing responds to calls for a further investigation into the treatment of Uyghur Muslims. And analysis from Gordon Chang on the latest developments on the origins of COVID-19. Private individuals in the United Kingdom continue their investigation into the treatment of Uyghurs and Turkish Muslims in China. Today, Beijing responded. A spokesman calls the tribunal, quote, hypocritical, ridiculous, and absurd. Beijing adds any findings from the investigation will be lies. The tribunal is led by a prominent lawyer who has worked with the International Criminal Court. Second hearing is set for tomorrow. There are new details this week on the possible origins of the coronavirus. They have emerged after American nonprofit The Intercept obtained more than 900 pages of material through the Freedom of Information Act. The documents reveal that research of the novel coronavirus in bats was federally funded by the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, and nearly $600,000 of that money was used to identify and work with coronaviruses that could infect humans. And joining us now is Gordon Chang, author of The Coming Collapse of China and The Great U.S.-China Tech War. Gordon, welcome back. Always great to see you. A lot to talk about, but first, let's get right to that report by The Intercept that found the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases provided more than $3 million in grants to fund COVID-19 research at that Wuhan lab. You know, this despite denials by Dr. Anthony Fauci back in May, telling Congress that the NIH has never funded gain-of-function research at that lab. Your thoughts?
Well, first of all, Tracy, there are actually two research papers, one from 2016, the other from 2017, that describes experimentation at the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And it talks about gain-of-function, and it also specifically refers to money from Dr. Fauci's institute. So this we've known. But what the Intercept pages do is they really provide a lot of detail that went into those two research papers. And they also call into question Dr. Fauci's state of mind that he knew about the possibility of a lab leak at the same time that he was telling the American public that it was really extremely unlikely. And this means that Dr. Fauci's answers to Rand Paul in May and July in the Senate looked like they're perjury. And if they're not perjury, then it shows that Dr. Fauci was grossly negligent in administering federal money.
And Gordon, in your opinion, what, if anything, should be done with this information that we now have?
Well, first of all, I think that Dr. Fauci owes the American public an explanation of all the facts that we've learned in these two requests from the Freedom of Information Act, the Intercept one and the one from the Washington Post. And then I think that if we learn what we suspect, then either there should be a Justice Department prosecution for perjury, or he should be fired. He should not be heading his position at the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases. That's clear.
You know, another thing on top of mind also, Gordon, is, you know, what is unfolding right now in Afghanistan. And it seems that China is now planning to take control of Bagram Air Base. And what more can you tell us about that and the significance there?
Well, Chinese military planners have been snooping around Bagram. And I think that they are there really to put together a Chinese installation. It may not be the whole air base, but it could be a significant portion of it. And we've seen China, for instance, in Cuba. They took over the Soviet listening post at Lourdes, which was the biggest Soviet listening post outside of the Soviet Union. So we know that China is embedded in a number of these installations around the world, and Bagram is just going to be the next one.
Yeah, and recently the Taliban said that China will be its main partner in helping to rebuild Afghanistan. And China has announced that it will provide more than $30 million worth of aid to Afghanistan. You know, we can see what the Taliban is getting out of this relationship. But what about China? And should the U.S. and possibly other countries be concerned about this partnership?
We should be extremely concerned because China can make the Taliban even more dangerous. The Chinese partnership with the Taliban is not new. It goes back before 9/11. During the insurgency, for instance, China was supplying arms to the Taliban, like shoulder-fired missiles, anti-aircraft guns, and the rest of it, that were used to kill American and NATO troops. Now, unfortunately, the United States didn't do anything then. That was a strategic and moral failure. So now we need to start looking at that relationship and pose costs on China for really very dangerous conduct which undermines the ability of the international community to achieve favorable outcomes.
Yeah, and I don't have a lot of time left, but I really want to talk about Taiwan. Just a few days ago, the Defense Ministry said that 19 Chinese warplanes entered its air defense identification zone. What more can you tell us about that? And at what point do you think the U.S. should or will get involved?
Yeah, those 19 planes on Sunday were the third straight day of China entering the air defense identification zone. And it really shows a step up of Chinese military provocations against the island republic. There had been a couple of months when the weather was not good, where China was letting up, but now they're back at it again. And this coincides with Beijing's propaganda that when China invades, and they use when, it means that the U.S. won't be there. Now, I think China is wrong, but what's important is not what we think. It's important what China thinks, because it could engage in adventurous behavior, which could trigger a broader conflict. Because if there's a conflict in the Taiwan Strait, it's going to ripple across the Eurasian landmass, because the Russians and the Iranians, among others, will take advantage of the situation in East Asia.
Yeah, so very concerning. Well, Gordon, thank you so much for your time today, and thank you for being with us.
Well, thank you, Tracy.
Up next, the faithful in Northern Ireland pay homage to St. Maximilian Kolbe. We'll explain. Tonight on EWTN Pro-Life Weekly, an interview with the state senator from Texas who wrote and sponsored the state's heartbeat law.
The civil lawsuits in this bill are against the doctor who performs an abortion on a little baby with a heartbeat or without checking for a heartbeat, and on those who aid and abet the doctor in that action. It specifically says the mother cannot be sued, and the law specifically says a rapist cannot bring a suit.
Republican Brian Hughes also clarifies misconceptions about the new heartbeat law. That is tonight on EWTN Pro-Life Weekly at 10 p.m. Eastern. You can also check out EWTN.com for other airing times. Following the terror attacks of September 11, 2001, national security became a priority. Now, 20 years after the attacks, the United States is in a precarious national security situation following the withdrawal of our troops from Afghanistan who were deployed there to ward off terrorists. Joining me now to discuss this is John Elliott, Republican strategist and former National Security Council spokesman under President Trump. John, welcome back. Great to see you again. Really hard to believe that it's been 20 years since 9/11. A lot has happened since then, but in some ways, things seem to remain the same. The Taliban is now back in control of Afghanistan. And this week, it actually named its new government, and those holding top positions have questionable pasts, to say the very least, including the interior minister, who's on the FBI's most wanted list and a designated global terrorist. Let's talk more about that and the implications.
Absolutely. Well, thanks for having me again, Tracy. First of all, whenever we think about, we're now 20 years from 9/11, so that's a long, long period of time, but it still doesn't erase the pain for those close to 3,000 families of those who died in both the World Trade Center, the Pentagon, Shanksville, Pennsylvania, et cetera. Those are families that we keep in our hearts always. But then this time of year especially, and now that we're at the 20-year anniversary, I mean, we're seeing kids who are probably 21, 22 years old who only knew their dad when they were little babies, et cetera. And so our hearts go out to those families. So with that said, if you take a look at what we've done over the last 20 years, some of it, first of all, we were very much welcomed by the international community right afterward. There was an outpouring of sympathy. I was working over in Europe at the time for an American company, and I remember the flowers that were outside the embassy in Germany. And then I remember an editorial from one of the liberal papers actually in Paris, one of the top papers, Le Monde, that said, "We are all Americans." And so there was this real outpouring. But then if you look over the next few years, we went into Afghanistan to get bin Laden, essentially. We got him 10 years later, just under 10 years later in 2011. But we also spent a lot of capital in places like Iraq and also in Afghanistan. And then we got into, if you look at what George Bush did when he was president, is that on the negative side, is that he started the whole idea of nation building, where we can go and be essentially building up nations like Afghanistan. And that's what's led us into the trouble that we're in right now, actually. And President Trump, to his credit, he started the negotiations to get us out, and he had us on a glide path to getting us out of Afghanistan. And he got us out of being right near Iraq and still concentrated on getting at our terror enemies. But at the same time, if you look, President Trump really did a great job about getting us out and putting that back in the box, where we're no longer looking to nation build in places like Afghanistan.
Yeah, and I'm going to ask you this, John. You know, the Saturday marks the 20th anniversary of September 11th. That said, do you think Americans are safer now than we were back then? And what can we do to ensure our safety?
Well, absolutely, Tracy. One of the great things about our response to 9/11, if you look aside for the nation building and us being in the Middle East, when, once again, if I take a look at, we allowed the buildup of China, which is a much bigger threat to us than terror groups that we can handle pretty well once we get concentrated. To your question, in terms of aviation security, it is night and day now compared with what it was on 9/11. There'd never be anybody be able to get into our planes with box cutters, with other items that the 9/11 hijackers were able to do. And now there's a really tough screening of anybody who's coming in from overseas after a shoe bomber or two. And we've learned very good lessons on that. But once again, if you look at, we are safer as a country against terrorists. There's a lot more focus on looking whether somebody has a bag in the wrong place, et cetera. And so there's a lot more vigilance on the part of the American people. But then also on the negative side is that, once again, for bigger threats to us than terrorism, such as the rise of China and China building itself into a huge nuclear power now and a huge naval power as well, that is something that we lost sight of from about 2000, 2003 all the way until now, until when President Trump started to concentrate on China and move us away from these forever wars and focus on the real threats to America going forward. So that's a positive thing. On both of those counts, we're better on aviation security, and we're better now on recognizing the bigger threats, even as we are tougher on terrorists and we're able to hit them where they are without having to be in Afghanistan or Iraq full time.
Yeah, well, John, thank you so much for your time and for your analysis. We always appreciate it. John Elliott, Republican strategist and former NSC spokesman under President Trump. Thank you again.
Thank you, Tracy.
And tomorrow on EWTN News Nightly, remembering 9/11 20 years later. Special reports from Ground Zero, the Pentagon, and Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Plus, conversations with Cardinal Timothy Dolan of New York and a 9/11 survivor. That's on EWTN News Nightly on Friday. And finally tonight, St. Maximilian Kolbe, who died in a concentration camp during World War II, is beloved in his native Poland. Earlier this week, he was also celebrated in Northern Ireland.
St. Maximilian Kolbe teaches each one of us to remember that the Word of God is within us and that each of us has a calling in our own baptism to be witnesses to the faith.
Archbishop Eamon Martin also unveiled a plaque dedicated to St. Maximilian. The events marked the 80th anniversary of his death. The ceremonies also featured the premiere of Two Chapels, a documentary film about St. Maximilian Kolbe. And we thank EWTN Poland for this story. And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.